In this moment, I believe that the presence of the Lord is in this place to do a marvelous work this morning. And I would challenge you to get out of your comfort zone today, and that you would step close to someone, that you would put your hand upon them if it's appropriate, and that you would begin to pray for them. God wants to do the miraculous in our midst this morning, but it will require the body of Christ ministering to one another today. So step out from where you are, put a hand upon your brother or sister, and pray the prayer of faith as they continue to sing this song. We must get out of the vessel of comfort and begin to walk upon the water if we are to expect the miraculous to take place, and not only in our lives, but in the lives of those that are around us. Would you begin to minister to one another this morning?
Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters where you would come. place with our voices and just lift it up to him this morning. With our lips, Lord Jesus, we magnify you. We worship you. We love you, Jesus. Surround us with your presence, Lord God. We make room for you in this place. Speak to us. Speak to our hearts. Speak to our minds. Speak to our family. Speak to this church. Moments.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. We worship you, oh God. We thank you for your faithful word. We thank you, God, for your touch. We thank you for your moving in our midst. We exalt you, oh God. We love you today, Jesus. Sorry. I like it when God does what he wants to do. And he'll always do what he wants to do if we'll let him. So I want to commend you this morning. Thank you for responding to the presence of the Lord and moving. And I know that we have a number of guests that are here this morning. And I know of one in particular, my good friend Sergio, one of my Starbucks friends, is here this morning. And we're crazy, right? We're crazy, right? Crazy in love for Jesus, he says. But what he doesn't probably remember, God gave me a prophetic word for him a few weeks ago, and he's gonna help me become more bilingual. And this is a fantastic young man. I'm excited about what God is doing in the lives of those that are in our lives. And so remember to continue to be a mouthpiece for God. Continue to let God use you wherever you are. Share the love of Jesus. Make a difference where you go. Now I better stop or I'm going to preach your message, Pastor. I'm going to ask that our ushers would come this morning. And if you are here today and you desire something of the Lord, The scripture talks about times where the presence of the Lord was there to heal. Now that could be physically, it could be emotionally, it could be spiritually, whatever it is today. I believe that God's already begun to do the work. And I would almost say, raise a hand if the Lord has done something for you this morning. If he has touched you in a special way today, praise God. Praise God. I'm thankful. I'm thankful for that. Praise God. Praise God. The Bible says, you have not because you ask not. So I'm going to ask for an offering this morning, and I'm going to believe that we're going to receive one. But sometimes we do not have in our lives because we think it's too trite or it's too big, and we don't want to bother God. How foolish is that, to think that the God who was willing to die on a cross, to give his everything that we might find salvation, would be too bothered with our seemingly insignificant requests, or our requests that we seem are overwhelming. Don't be afraid to ask him. Bring them to Jesus and let him do the work in your life today. Amen. So before I receive this offering this morning, I'm going to ask that they would put our slide up. I want to do one thing. I want to, if you ever start something in affirmation and then you get in about halfway and you put a conjunction in there, like a but statement, right? Everybody knows that the first part gets flushed. Nobody cares about that. It didn't mean nothing. So here's what I'm going to go backwards today. I want to tell you that our goal this year for pledged offerings was $180,000. And as you can see, our pledged amount to this point is roughly $139,000. But if you will look at what's been given to date, roughly $57,000, that is a third of what our goal was that we would receive. Now, I believe that God will honor that which we have appropriated, that we have set aside to give to him for his work. And I believe that we'll get to the end of the year and we'll say, look what the Lord has done, and we will have surpassed what our goal is. But it requires the faithfulness of his people to continue to give and to give to the vision. And so this morning, as we receive this offering, I'm going to pray specifically that God would move us, and that maybe if you're here and you've not yet made a pledge, that you would say, I want to get in on what this church is doing. There are publications in the foyer. You can pick them up. You can look at what we did last year. But this is a global church. This is not just a church that ministers to itself, or even the community, or the state that it's in, or the nation it's a part of. But this is a church that gives globally and is making a difference around the world, spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we get to be a part of that. And so this morning, as we receive our tithes and offerings, allow the Lord to speak to you and give according to his voice this morning. Let's all stand together. And let's honor the Lord, and let's pray a prayer of blessing upon this offering. And then, and I'm going to pray, but I want to celebrate one more thing. Each and every week we come up here and we have different ways of celebrating one of the greatest things that happens in this church, and it's new birth. And I'm going to go from memory, but I believe it's Gabriella Turner was baptized, there it is, was baptized last week in the name of Jesus Christ. That's something we're celebrating. I give God thanks for what he's doing in our midst. And if you're here today and you've had a Bible study and you understand the importance of being baptized, you can be baptized today. You can go under the water in the name of Jesus Christ and come up a brand new person. You can receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost today. So if I'll just put this out there. If you want to be baptized, please come see me today and we'll make sure that you get baptized today. Amen. Let's pray for the offering today. Lord Jesus, we love you and we thank you, oh God, for your faithfulness to us. And I pray today, God, that we would, in our giving, show our faithfulness back to you, God. The thing that you have entrusted to us, Lord, you have required a tithe of us. Lord, and that tithe isn't because you need our money. But that tithe is to see if we're obedient, if we trust you, Lord, that you will continue to provide for our needs. And this morning, I pray that as your people give sacrificially, God, that you will continue to bless them. And Lord, those that are here that have not to give, I pray, Lord, on credit, that you would open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon them, that they might stand in a place and say, look what God has done for me. Bless this offering today. Bless the word that we're about to receive in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let's go ahead and put our hands together this morning. And I'm not surprised at all. I had this
remarkable expectation. And I think every time we come together, we should expect something. But my expectation was heightened. It was sensitized, so to speak, before the service. Went into the prayer room, and it seemed like it was getting louder and louder and louder. I opened my eyes, and I saw about 30 men standing in the prayer room. They had to stand. There were not seats for them, and so they were standing. And I want to say something about our service tonight, edify. We began this year doing something a little bit different in anticipation that God was going to take us someplace. Now, this is going to be, and I've already said, a work in progress. This is developing, and let me say that we're going somewhere that we've not been before. We had prayer on Saturday morning with the men, and at the conclusion of it, generally I would get up and I would have something that I would say, and I just kind of was waiting on the Lord to give me a thought, something that would be of value. And it occurred to me that what ministry has become is one person doing the same thing all of the time. And the Lord just did not give me anything whatsoever, but said, I'm going to give it to somebody else. And so I got them together, and we began to talk, and I shared this with them. I said, I wonder if God has spoken to one of you. And immediately two men said, God's given me something. And this is where I think that God really wants to take us, that we all become ministers, which indeed we are. God has gifted us. And so can you imagine an evening service where that sort of thing is happening just spontaneously? And so how do we get there? Well, the answer is the same way we got here this morning. The answer really is prayer. It's prayer. I want to extend this invitation again, and that is that our service begins at 6 o'clock. I know there are intercessors, and you know, they are thoroughbreds. Thoroughbreds are horses that are just, they're bred to run. These people are bred to pray. You can't hold them down. You can't hold them back. And so if they come anytime they want until 5:30, if they want to go into the prayer room because there is some rehearsal that's taking place here, but at 5:30, I want you to come and communicate. Now, some people praying half an hour it's not a hard thing for them to do, and they may want to come at 5:30, and if you're one of those people at about 15 minutes, I'm one of those I can really pray for 15 minutes. Come 15 minutes early. If you could pray 5 minutes, come 5 minutes early. I'd love to see us just be up here at this altar. It may work out that 6 o'clock comes and we won't even have to begin the service because God is already doing something. Amen. Oh, look, we'll have something prepared, but if God starts to move, we're just going to go with him. We're going with God. We're going with him. And so, praise God. I want to say one more thing, and this is about, of course, our small groups. I love our small groups. I have a small group of men, and we're in this series of becoming a contagious Christian, which is really all about discovering the natural way that we can reach people. And if you haven't already been in this series, and I know most of you have, but if you haven't, it's not too late. Get into it. You'll discover that there are 6 different ways that we can share the gospel that are natural to us. I know these guys, and if you would have said which way is right for them, I could have pinpointed every one of us. This is his way, that's their way. And you know, even before I went through the series, I had an idea of what mine would be. But now that we've studied that, I know what I'm supposed to do. And so I just want to encourage you, listen, the small group life that we're going through right now is going to be, it's so valuable for us, but it's going to be so valuable to your family, and it's going to be valuable to your friends and your neighbors and your coworkers. Amen. Praise God. If you'd like to take your Bibles, I'd like you to turn with me, and I'd like you to go to, this is Matthew chapter 5. I'm going to ask you to stand for just a moment longer as I prepare this for you in your hearts and in your minds. And by giving you a little bit of a setup, and then we'll pray. We find early, this is now early in Jesus' ministry, that he delivers this incredible message. What was it called? It was a Sermon on the Mount. You know, when you look at what was going on, we find that Jesus saw masses of people, and he separated himself from them. And he went up to a mountain, and his followers, his disciples, came to him, and he sat down, and he began, the Word of God tells us, to teach them this message. This message was not for everybody. It is a message for the church. There are always going to be others. I assure you, there were others that were examining this, looking into it. Some that might have just begun their search, began their journey. And I realized that there are some of those here today. Jesus spoke, and he spoke about his kingdom. An amazing kingdom. A culture. A counterculture to the world. And he begins with what is the Beatitudes. Some people play with words and they say they are the Beatitudes. The attitudes to be. Beatitudes are a word for blessings or promises that you are going to receive. And he said, blessed are the poor. Blessed are those that mourn. Blessed are the meek. And then he tells them what the result of that is going to be. What's going to happen? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers, and blessed are the persecuted. Blessed, of course, means happy. Not just a little happy. It means so fortunate. There isn't an English word. Blessed just does not tell what this Greek word means. It means you are highly favored. Highly favored. We're not talking about rewards for what you do. We're talking about grace. Not something we deserve. We're just posturing ourselves. We're just setting ourselves up for God's grace for the believer to receive. And then, right after all these blessings, Jesus goes on to talk about what we are in the world. And he uses 2 metaphors, and if you'd like to read on with me, this is Matthew chapter 5 and verse 13. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its favor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify. We said, Lord, cover the earth with your glory. Do you know that you are an agent for that? Glorify your Father in heaven. This morning we're going to be talking to you about salt and light. Would you lift your voices and pray with me? Praise God. Father, thank you, Lord. Lord, thank you for being here in such a powerful, such a wonderful way, dear God. Thank you for what you've already done. The hands represented, dear Lord, that have gone up, who've been touched by you, have received something from you. But you are not finished yet, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would take your word and, Lord, let it take hold in our hearts, Lord. Let it have an effect. Let us not just be hearers this morning, dear God. Let us position ourselves right now, Lord, to be doers, Lord, of your word, by your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. You may be seated. Let's clap our hands to the Lord again. Thank you, Lord. You notice from these verses, it does not say, by the way, you should be salt. You should be light. It doesn't say, you know something, you will be salt. It doesn't say you will be light. It doesn't say you can be light. It doesn't say, you know, if you really work at it, you can be salt. It doesn't say that. You know what it says? It says, you are salt, the salt of the earth, and you are light. You are the light of the world. He is describing here what really makes us stand out, what separates us from the world that is around us. As true believers, we're in the world. We're not of the world. Jesus prayed for us. He prayed for his disciples, but he prayed for us. This is what he prayed. Here's his words. He said, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I don't pray that you take them out. You're in. But you are not of the world. Jesus wants us here. He has us right where he wants us to be, in a place that we are different from everyone around us. And we're different in so many ways. And two of them are that we are to be salt. We are salt, and that we are light. And I find this a rather fascinating thing to say right after the very last beatitude. Let me read that last beatitude to you. It says, blessed are they who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. It says, blessed are you when men revile you, that is, abuse you to the face, and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice, it says, in the middle of that. Don't be sad. Don't be down. Don't let that change you in a negative way. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. He's saying, by living, why was Jesus so hated? Because he was doing what was right, what was good. I could just see him bringing conviction and bringing
perhaps the feeling of shame to a lot of people that were listening to him, the self-righteous and those that had no relationship with God whatsoever. And so does it make sense that if we become like him, that we too are going to experience that same feeling that people have? But nevertheless, it doesn't matter. Right after he says that, he said, you are still to be. You still are salt. You still are the light of the world. Expect to be mistreated. We say this, expect it. Expect it. But it should not change who you are at all. If anything, you say, oh, hallelujah. I'm doing it right. Amen. We still have an effect on the world for good. The world hates Christians. And of course, nevertheless, they are absolutely dependent upon them. The people that despise you, they need you. And of course, you are to make, the whole idea is that you are to make a difference. You're to have an impact on their life. You are to have an influence on them. Salt and light are two extraordinarily effective agents. Time would prevent me from getting into all of the things that I can detail about how salt is a value to us. I can touch on a couple of the obvious ones. First of all, it adds flavor, does it not? I'm going to tell you something I haven't told my grandchildren. They love my pancakes. Some of them are going to discover today, for the very first time, what is in my secret recipe. Withheld this for so long. By the way, this is not a scratch pancake. I can do that too. But this is where you take the box of the mix and you just throw water in there. But I add two different ingredients, just two other ingredients. And it makes the difference for them. And it's vanilla and salt. Boy, there's something about salt and sweet. When you start putting those things together, it makes a difference. Salt was much more before, and still to some degree, it's also used as a preservative. Without refrigeration, of course, back then they used salt to cure meat, to cure fish so that it wouldn't spoil it. It's also a natural antibacterial property, you know, that was used. And if you read the Old Testament, they actually took salt and they rubbed it on their infants when they were born. Might seem like a strange thing to do. Because of its value, it had a lot of symbolic meaning. As a matter of fact, the Old Testament speaks of having these covenants of salt because of the value of salt and the importance of salt. It was used, if you read the Old Testament, it was part of the law. It was used in their sacrifices. It was so valued, as a matter of fact, it was payment to Roman soldiers. And of course, thus came the expression, they are not worth their salt. When it comes to light, of course, we think about how it illuminates things so they can be so clearly seen. And it has, it even has some, you might say, medicinal properties, in that it has healing properties mentally and physically. Without it, of course, we couldn't live. Nothing would grow without light. We couldn't even exist. And Jesus states the obvious here. He says that if salt, though, if it loses its flavor, it's useless. He says this about light. He said, light, if it's covered up, it's of no value whatsoever. God wants your life, your life, to have an effect on the world around you. So that the world will come to some understanding. So that the world will know something. So the world can learn something. So the world can conclude something about God, something about God's nature that is so wonderful. It's so great. So they will give God the glory, therefore, that he deserves. Your life is to make God, your life is to make God stand out. He said, if I be lifted up, if people can get a view of him, if they can get a glimpse of him, I'll draw all men to me. We've been focusing, of course, on making disciples, and that requires for us to be able to have an effect on the world around us. You know, we have got to influence them. It requires our influence in a positive way. Now, commentators, by the way, who've read these scriptures, and I've read them, they have said, okay, the reason that you're supposed to be salt and the reason that you're supposed to be light is that we are supposed to add taste to the world for God. So they're basically saying this. They're saying, you know, if we weren't here, God would just kill everybody, you know? Well, that's not the God of the New Testament that I know. God is a God of grace. We are living in a dispensation of grace. And so the meaning is something else. What it really means is that we are to add God's taste to the world. That's the idea. That we will, other people will taste the Lord and know that he is good. It's not to prevent God's wrath. It's to bring God's blessing to mankind as they begin to glorify him for who he is. We expose our life. We expose our life to the world with righteousness and peace and joy that God has given to us. And whether you know it or not, or whether they know it or not, it is what they're looking for. That is what they want. You look closely. You just look closely. I mean, they will try to make you think everything's fine. It's not fine. If you look closely, you're going to find out they're depressed. You're going to find out they're pretty bored. You're going to find out they're pretty lonely. You're going to find out they don't really have very much meaning in life. And you may think, well, that's what you say, but they don't think that. I'm not talking, by the way, let me point out to you, it's easy for us to find the people that are drug addicts, you know, and say, yeah, I can see the hopelessness. I want to put everybody into this bag. Everybody that doesn't know Jesus. The reason I say that is because there are so many people that are just saying, you know something, I'm so close to experience a breakthrough when it comes to happiness because I've got this job and if I could just, yeah, I know this person and if I could just, I had that house, but if I could just improve my situation. Reading from the Wall Street Journal about a survey done by Bill Gates of 120 people that have $25 million or more. These are from the people that are at the place where everybody's saying, if I could just, I'm close. I know that I'm not as happy as I like to be, but I'm close. If I could just get to that place. Listen to what they say about people that have wealth envy, that are saying, all I need is just a little bit more. These are their words. If they knew wealth didn't necessarily bring them all that they had hoped for, then maybe they would concentrate on the things that make a world a better place, that bring true happiness. Did you hear what they said? By making the world a better place, that they can find true happiness. I can't think of a way of making the world a better place than to be salt and to be light. The way to overcome the misery of this world is to be in harmony with the one who made us. The one who created us. And together, you know something? We can help. We can make a difference. Now, listen, you might think, well, I'm one grain of salt. What difference does one grain of salt? Well, in a very small amount of food, one grain can make a difference. We're talking about reaching everybody, by changing a society or changing a culture. It's going to take more than one grain. It's going to take all of us. One candle, frankly, is not going to do much to light all the darkness. But together, we can be a city on a hill, Jesus said. Together with Christians all over the world, I want you to know we can make a profound difference. If people... aren't flocking the churches, if they're not running to get into the doors, It's because they're not hearing or seeing something that they want or need. Think about that. The world has this idea about faith that is so skewed. First, that Christians are supposed to be good. They get that right. But they're all hypocrites. They go to church on Sunday, but they're not good. If anybody ever says to you, and this might happen, you know, where they'll say, "You're a Christian?" You go to church? That tells me two things. Number one, they know Christians are supposed to be different. And that tells me they don't think that you are. Ever notice how, listen, let me tell you how this works, and that is, if you don't think that they know there's a difference, if you start telling people you're a Christian, all of a sudden, their language changes. All of a sudden, the stories that they were telling, they don't tell them in your presence. If something slips up, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say that, you know? But the common misconception, that we have in the world today is that you are dull. Oh, this is so funny. You are boring. Is anybody bored this morning? You know, people looked in here and they say, "Well, I'll tell you one thing, they're not bored. They're not dull." Listen, the life of Jesus was anything but boring. Anything but dull. His life was captivating. It was consuming. His life was passionate. His life, and I dare to say, his life was exciting. If the unbeliever, if people who are outside of faith in Christ, if they knew how meaningful, if they knew how fulfilling, if they knew how beautiful, if they knew how joyous, if they knew how stimulating, you know, that you are, they will be floored. And then they're going to want to look into what it is you're drinking, what it is you're doing, you know, that causes you to be that way. They will discover that God loves you so much that he pours his favor upon your life. And that no matter what we are going through, that we are blessed. We are blessed. Praise God. But our flavor, we are salt. But our flavor, it can be lost. It can be. Let me say this. It happens, and you know, we have Morton salt, we have Himalayan salt, we have kosher salt, and all of it is pure salt. And so when we put that in our food, we taste it, you know. But back then, they had salt, and much of it was mined. It was mined out of this area around the Dead Sea. And there were so many elements that were also in it that it contaminated it. This is very interesting, and that is that so it wasn't of any value, so they threw it out. Now watch this, okay? You take salt, it's of no value, you throw it out on the road, and it makes the surface harder. Think about the sower that goes out and sows the seed. Seed falls on the hard places, but it never grows. If we aren't being salt and we're thrown out, we're making it harder. We're making it more difficult for the word to ever take root in somebody's heart. Would you say amen? Amen. Praise God. Same thing happens when we cover the light. You know, Oz Guinness, he said this. He said, the problem with Christians is not that they aren't where they should be. We are exactly where we should be. He goes on to say, but they are not what they should be right where they are. I, I need to be better at this. I'll be perfectly honest with you. Every once in a while, God shows me. God lets me know, no. You could be a little tastier. God knows I could be a little brighter, that's for sure. It was revealed to me more than ever on this vacation that I had. I had a chance to get down to Florida, and it's warm down there. And so I grabbed some golf clubs and took them down there and got to golf. It was late in the vacation time. I had just 2 days left, and so I got to do this. And I called right away to this particular resort has a couple of different courses on it, and I called the best course that they had, and I said, I want to golf on a really good course. And so the odd thing, strange thing happened. And that is I called and they said, well, Mr. Tamil, we've got you scheduled for 1:15. Now, they don't want people going out by themselves. If you know anything about golf, they want you teamed up with people and a foursome is what they're trying to achieve. And so when I got there, I went out to the starter and I was by myself. There, nobody was ahead of me. And I said, am I going up by myself? And he said, there's no threesome coming. You'll be here in just a moment. Just wait. Don't you go over there and putt some balls? So I'm over there putting some balls. And lo and behold, the threesome comes up. They're having a conversation with the starter. And this is what they said. We don't want him with us. I didn't take it personal. I mean, they didn't know me. And so I just realized, you know, that sometimes, you know, and I've been in the situation where the fourth guy didn't quite fit. And so I said, not a problem. He said, there's another threesome coming. And I said, hey, there's nobody yet. Listen. They're not going to catch me. There's nobody in front of me. Why don't you just let me go by myself? He said, sure. So I started off, and because I'm golfing by myself, I'm not waiting for other people to hit. I'm starting to move forward. I'm catching up to the group that's in front of me. And the group that's in front of me is just a man and his son. So as I got close to them, they were close enough to say to me, hey, you want to join us? I said, sure. So I joined them. It was a man, he's in his 50s, and his son's 24. Son looked very thin. And there was something about his coloring that just wasn't right. Wore a hat, and the hat was on his head, but also covered the ends of his ears. As we got into our conversation, periodically we were walking together. I said, what do you guys do? And he said, well, we're from Quebec. In fact, the son had a rather strong French accent. Did not speak English as well as his dad. And he said, I'm a businessman. He said, and I develop a product, have a product made, I sell it in Canada, and I sell it in America. But then we've come down here, we've been down here three times now during the winter to do some golfing down here. We're not staying at this resort. We're not here at this resort. Just happened to be at this course. At this time. He said, what do you do? I said, I'm a pastor. He said, oh. He says, you know, Quebec, when I was growing up, the churches, big churches, had a lot of people in them. He said, they're empty now. I said, you know, it seems to be going a little way that Europe does. They have great churches of the past, but they're more like museums. And he said, yeah, that's the way that it is. He said, oh, do you know, who John of God is. I'm thinking right away, the apostle? You know, that's what I'm thinking, you know? I said, I'm not sure. He said, he's been with Oprah. Well, then I knew it wasn't him. he said, he's from Brazil. And I said, no, I've never heard of him. And he said, well, he has a healing ministry. He said, my son is sick. My wife heard that John of God was going to be in New York, so they flew from Quebec. They flew down there, and he prayed for my son. And I said, oh, let me tell you, I believe in the healing power of God. I do. And I said, that's wonderful. How is he doing? And he said, he thinks he's doing better. I said, well, you know, I'm pleased to hear that. We finished the game, the course, okay? So I'm getting in my car, and I realized I did something wrong.
or I didn't do something right. God said, you were supposed to pray for him. Now I can make all kinds of excuses and say, John of God, pray for him already. They were gone. I was gone. That's the day, 2 days before I'm leaving on a Friday morning. This is Wednesday. So Thursday morning, I get up and I'm driving through the subdivision. As I'm driving up, I come up to a crossing area where golf carts cross over. You have to stop for them. And this was a different course. Don't stay at that resort. This is a different course. And lo and behold, folks, what are the odds? There they go. They didn't even see me. You know, they just went by. We called Ruth. Ruth is a person that we know at the resort that we talk to periodically. She works there. And so Diane and I, we said, let's take Ruth to lunch. We call Ruth up. Ruth says, I have to take a late lunch, 1 o'clock. I said, 1's fine. That's not a problem. Where do you want to meet? Breezes. Okay, we'll meet you there. Two places in Breezes. There's the inside and the outside. There's people sitting on the inside, people sitting on the outside. Diane says, where do you want to sit? I said, let's go outside. So I sat down, and we're sitting there talking, waiting for Ruth. And Diane's looking at me, and she says, don't turn around right now. She said, I think the people that you described to me, I think they're sitting at the table right next to us. I turned around, and there they were. I got up, walked over to him. I'm supposed to pray for you. I said, before you leave, I sat down with Diane. We spent a little time with Ruth. I looked over. They were finishing their meal. I got up, walked down, sat down. I said, let me tell you a little bit about, Jesus Christ. Spent probably 10 minutes talking to them. And when I got done talking to them about why God wants me to pray for him, that is bigger than he realizes. Now, by the way, these are not religious people. In fact, when I prayed for them, they just looked at me. I had my eyes closed. I opened my eyes at the end, and they're just staring at me. Amen. Well, I knew it was what God wanted me to do. Now, we were talking a little bit about blessings and joy and what comes as a result of that. I will tell you this, that little moment, that incident, that made me happier. It's still making me happy. It is still making... The 18 holes were lousy next to this. So what is saltiness, by the way? What is saltiness? Let me just say that being salty means... It means being like Jesus. Whatever you imagine Jesus to be, that's saltiness. Having salt is having... It's having purity and holiness of life. It has to do with being passionate. Passionate about God. It's about being authentic. It's about being sincere. It's about caring for others. And the beauty of that is that God gives us grace so that we are that. I can't do that. I can't make that happen by myself. God, He does that for us. These things add flavor wherever you go. Praise God. Let the savor of your Christian life be tasted. Be a Christian. When you leave here, be a Christian.
Show them what it really means, not just to be a Christ follower, but to experience God's blessing in your life. And I will tell you, if you do that, wherever you go, something wonderful is going to happen. Don Malice, our men's pastor, he has a Tuesday morning group over at Denny's here. Been meeting for years with those guys. So what do? Well, they bring their Bibles. They talk about Jesus. They pray together. 2 weeks ago, they're together and they're having one of their normal meetings. And as they're talking, a hand slips up behind Don and puts a piece of paper on the table. And they disappear. They're gone. Don takes it and he opens it up and he reads. This is a receipt things? The guy didn't have something to write on. He must have gone to the desk. And the waitress, he said, if I get a piece of paper to write on, and he writes this. Hi, guys. Sorry to bother y'all. Just wondering if you can say a prayer for my dad. He's very ill. Don't want to disturb you guys. Thanks. My name is, and he gives his name. And he said, my dad's name is, and he gives his dad's name, and he tells him which hospital his dad is in. And he says, my phone number is, and he puts his phone number down, and he says, thank you in advance, and then way down here on the bottom, this is what he says. He writes, you are sent by God. We are. Now, there's a side story. I don't have as much time as I would like to be able to tell you about this, but one of the men that were at the table, very disappointed, a Bible study fell through, and so he was the one who won the phone number. He's already got the name. He's already called the guy. They've already begun to have some discussion, and he's so happy now, all because he let his light shine, all because that group, they were salt. We have a mission statement in this church, and you know that mission statement. It says, know Christ and show Christ. I want you to think about this. It means know what Christ was like, and then show him. Praise God. That's what light really is, isn't it? What is light? It is doing what Jesus would do. It's those deeds that are talked about. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. By the way, he said, I am the light of the world. But then he turns around and he says, well, you are the light of the world. And don't be confused by that at all. See, his brightness is the brightness of the sun. Ours is the reflection of that. We'd be the brightness of the moon. We're reflecting his glory. Lesser light, but still light nevertheless. Our light is seen in our works, good works. Praise God, that testify of God's grace and God's love. This church is indeed a church of good works. This was If Sunday Faith Initiatives, and we do good things. I would tell you that we support missionaries and unwed mothers, and we help orphans, and we help the hungry. And this is kind of a macro scale of what we do. In a micro scale, We prepare meals for shut-ins, and we teach English to immigrants that are coming in, and we give rides, and we become friends. And you reflect God's love. And when you do, he receives all the glory. There's a bit of a dichotomy, and that is that our good works should be seen. And then later on, he says in the same message, and he says, make sure that you don't do your charitable deeds before men, to be seen by them. What's the difference? The difference is motive. See, the idea is that people see Christ in us when the motive is right. We do what we do because we want to honor him. Done with the right motive, you're going to find that people are going to applaud his work in their life through you. But light and salt have to
have to do also with bringing the gospel. It's one thing just to live a holy life in front of people. It's another thing, you know, to share that truth with them, you know. So we do that. We are light and we are salt in our conversation. In Colossians, Paul wrote this. He said, let your conversation always, let it be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. Let it be full of grace. Grace is wisdom. Grace is truth. That's what the light is. And then there is the salt. The salt is that when we speak to them, that we speak with love, that we speak passionately about what we believe in, that we are sincere, that we are authentic, that what we say is heartfelt. That's salt. And I promise you, if you have that conversation with them, you will have their attention. There's no question about that. The end of the story, by the way, is that when I was talking to the man and his father, all I said was, my name is Anthony. I am a pastor from a church in Wisconsin. That's all I said. I'm driving back, and we're driving up to Georgia, and I get a contact from Dawn, our secretary of office workers. She said, you know, Pastor, she said, I think this might be for you. There's an email the church got. If this is to Anthony, who talked to my son and I, prayed for my son, we want to continue to have contact with you. God's not done. God's not done. Would you stand? Hallelujah. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. You are. Be salty. Be bright for his glory. Lastly, I want to point out to you, and that is that salt causes thirst. Let me say that again. People start tasting your salt, they're going to be thirsty. They're going to be thirsty for the living water that you already have. This is God's plan. This is God's plan for your life. This is God's plan for you. Wherever you are, this is God's plan. And by the way, there's no other. It's you. He's not sending angels to do this. It's you. It's you. It's a great plan. Just be who you are in Jesus, wherever you go. You say, well, that's his responsibility. No, I don't see it that way at all. It's an opportunity to be like Jesus. Amen. I see it. I see this all as not duty. I see this as a way of honoring the one who loves me. And the one that I love back. The one that who's done so many things for me. Amen. Well, yesterday morning we were at men's prayer and Randall sang a song. Led the men in singing. And it was the song Amazing Love. And as I was listening to the words, I thought, oh, that's really a good song. Sort of tells what I'm thinking. What I want to say to the congregation, and you know these words, it says, I am forgiven because you were forsaken. I am accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Woo! Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Goes on to say, amazing love. How can it be that you, my king, would die for me? Amazing love. I know it's true. Now watch this. And it's my joy to honor you. In all I do,
I honor you. Let's sing it together. Praise God.
And I'm forgiven because you were forsaken.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I'm accepted. You were condemned.
Oh, yes. I'm alive.
And I'm alive and well.
Oh, I'm alive.
Your spirit is within me.
Your spirit's in me. Because you died and rose again. Oh, yes. Hallelujah.
Amazing love.
How can it be? You, my king.
You, my king, should
die for me. Amazing love. And all I do,
I honor you.
Praise God. This altar is open. Amen. Pastor Tim talked a little bit earlier about, you know, something. You can be baptized in Jesus' name. We've talked about in salt and light. And I will tell you, anybody on the outside realizes that they can make a difference in the world, I will tell you, they would want to take that step. That step is toward Jesus. It's having your sins put under the blood of Jesus Christ and getting a fresh new start, starting all over again, so that in all you do, you can give honor to Him. Praise God. You can do that today. Hallelujah. Praise God.